to use in an individualistic theory, the wavelength obviously there is a 532 nanometer. With a double crystal, you can switch on the laser, which is generally used in surgery and biology on soft tissues. The advantage of the KDB laser is that it is capable of selective absorption, especially the pigments and the blood. The handheld probe and the micromanipulator, you can use not only handheld probe, and that means that you can look around the corner immediately if the laser vibrates in your hand, but you can attach it to the micromanipulator and you can use it similarly to the CO2 laser in the pharynx, larynx, and oral cavity. The other big advantage is that you get better of ketting, vaporization, and also coagulation. here are some drawings regarding the physical characteristics of ketting, vaporization, and coagulation. You can use one pulse, which is which means minimal safety. Maximal safety. If you use it in a pulsing mode, that's a middle safety, and if you use it continuously, that's a minimal safety. And just under is the applied laser ray. You can see the necrotic area of the tissue, and under is the necrotic area, you can see a coagulation. Here are some examples regarding cutting. You can cut out a tympanic osteotic plaque from the tympanic membrane. Tympanic osteotic plaque in the tympanic membrane can be disadvantageous regarding the sound transmission. And you can remove the superstructure, as especially in cholesterol cases. Another application of cutting. When you go through the adhesions around the stapes cruda, these adhesions can also block the transmission of the sound in the milieu. This is just an example of how we cut a part of the tympanic membrane. In this particular case, the stainless epithelium, which is on the lateral part of the tympanic membrane, turns medially, and if you don't remove the edge of the tympanic membrane in a bloodless way, you can end up with stainless epithelium in the middle ear, which is a sort of cholesteratoma, and that needs to be avoided in the surgery. Sorry about the shining, but means that application needs a special training. This is a post-cavity surgical procedure, and this is the so-called posterior tympanotomy. The posterior tympanotomy is a approach in the middle ear from the mastoid cavity, and you can see that the anterior border is the posterior ear canal, and the posterior border is the facial nerve. You can see the incus around the oscular chains. And if you are not 100% sure whether or not there is some squamous epithelial remnant around the oscular chain, you can vaporize it with the laser and you can prevent the cholesterol formation. This is our first short patient collection, 32 combined approach tympanoplasties. The first series, 19 cases under the second procedure, two residual cholesterol response. This result is much better compared with the non-laser cases. No yatterin excessive activity was found, and no facial palsy was reported in this first series. From the point of view of the vertigo, because of the very limited movement of the oscular chain and the very delicate handling of the oscular chain, this procedure proved to be advantageous from the vertical point of view as well. Occasionally, experience certainly a bit mild postoperative pain, which was mentioned quite easily. Difficulties, and this is the advantages of the laser assisted surgery, tympanoplasty. The cochlear trauma has been used because you don't have to manipulate very heavily the oscular chain. The tissue handling is achromatic. Much less adhesions and scar tissues can be found later on if you open up the ear again around the oscular chain. Excellent hemostasis can be achieved. And on the long run, the ratio of residual is less. There are some difficulties, certainly regarding the laser assisted approach. It needs a special training. The instrument is quite expensive. Regular maintenance is a compulsory thing. You have to concentrate on the safety issues, especially when you work in a close vicinity to the eye. And also, special laser tubes needs to be ordered. Especially at the beginning, the operation time is a little bit longer, but then you get used to it. And if you are in a very good cooperation with your theater staff, the operative time is getting less and less. A special issue is burning around the ear, which certainly needs to be avoided. But the next topic is the laser assisted meningoplasties. And you have a perforated tympanic membrane. You can have your results with the laser application. The perforation can be in any places of the tympanic, any quadrants of the tympanic membrane. The most difficult and most complicated part of the perforated tympanic membrane is located anteriorly. Why? Because overhanging of the anterior external auditory canal is quite common, and that makes the approach very difficult. Anatomically, this is the most unfavorable situation. If you apply local anesthesia, the anterior wall is the one which is the most difficult to anesthetize properly. If you use overlay technique, which means that the graft, the tympanic membrane graft, is lateral to the middle layer, the cartilage layer of the tympanic membrane, it's quite easy to end up with blunting lateralization of the graft. The other problem is that the blood supply of the anterior coronal is quite poor, and as a consequence, the reperforation is a real option. So, I just remind you to the saying of Schoenheim, one of the most influential pathologists of the last century, who said that surgical skill is an important fact in cases of meningoplasties affecting the anterior. This is a first patient cohort when we started to use this technique. 10 male patients, 30 women, one operation was carried out bilaterally. The average age was 36.5 years. Regarding these series, the first operation was performed in 1997, the last one in 2004. From that point onwards, we have certainly had a lot more surgeries, but we published our first results regarding these 22 patients. The average follow-up was nearly 3 years, and the autological follow-up was carried out by a homemade software, which was produced by one of my colleagues. This is the surgical technique. Subtotal perforation was found in 9 cases. Anterior quadrant, this is the anterior quadrant. This is the anterior inferior, anterior superior. This is the posterior superior, posterior inferior quadrant. Subtotal, and nearly all the quadrants are affected. Only a little tiny ring is left behind. Subtotal perforation was found in 9 cases. Anterior quadrant perforation in 8 cases. Anterior superior perforation in 4 cases. And anterior plus posterior inferior quadrants in 2 cases. And in all the cases, the anterior quadrants were affected. This is the most difficult part of the treatment. So this is the technique and the philosophy behind the data. This is the ground implant, which is freed from the malleus. And we always use a big fascia with a split of 4-5 millimeter in the middle of the edges. This is the picture of the under-ear positioning of the drum remnant. And finally, the graft, the new drum, which is nearly exclusively fascia of the muscle, double fixation, anterior superiorly, just in front of the short process, and at the border of the anterior borders, we pull back the edge of the graft in between the body edge and the tympanic membrane angles. That helps you to fix the drum properly on the two places. Canaloplasty, which means enlargement of the external anterior canal, is always part of the procedure. Why? Because the intensive mobilization of the soft tissue, I think, helps the final healing rate. If you mobilize that tissue, soft tissue in the ear canal, that helps your healing. That speeds up your healing process. And what I try to achieve is to see the wall perforation in one particular aspect of the microscope. Not to speak about the fact that if you have a good wide ear canal, the follow-up is much easier, not only for the surgeon, but for the patients as well. The second step is the detachment of the drum remnant from the malleus handle. Maybe some of you will find this step a little bit controversial, but with the use of the laser, And finally, I would like to speak about the laser application regarding stapes surgery. Stapes fixation is a very common problem in especially middle-aged ladies and gentlemen, to our best knowledge, the stapes fixation is caused in about 70% of the cases otosclerosis. I don't know whether you have heard about this disease. This is provoked and initiated by varicella virus, and the final result of the is to our best knowledge. And the final result is that the liposcular chain called stapes is fixed in the lower window. So how you can solve this problem? You can remove this fixed ossicular structure, you create a little hole with the laser on the stapes quickly, and the final reconstruction is performed with a piston which connects the middle ossicular chain, that member of the middle ossicular chain, the member of the ossicular chain, that's the incus, that piston connects the incus with the inner. So this is how you can create a nice movable ossicular chain with a replacement of the fixed stapes in the prosthesis. So the first gentleman who carried out the first modern stapes surgery was John Shee back in 1956 in the United States. In one of his memories back in 1998, he said that since 1956, when he performed the first modern stapes surgical procedure, the most significant technical innovation in stapes surgery has been the introduction of laser technology. This is the first plastic prosthesis. We don't use this sort of plastic prosthesis. You can see that it looks like the original stapes, plus there's an extension superiorly with a four lip for the incus. From my last time, this seems to be a quite complicated prosthesis. We use a lot more simple prosthesis now for hearing restoration. This is Professor Plaster from Germany, who introduced the Bachelor Staphylectomy procedure. This gentleman is Harold Schulknecht, a very influential guy from the last century, from the United States. He was also very influential in developing new techniques and new type of prosthesis. And this is John Bernard Coase, who had his private clinic in France. He was the one who performed nearly 7,000 stapes operations during his active career. Probably he is the one who has performed most of the stapes surgeries. As you have heard from Professor Kennedy before, there are plenty of lasers used in otolaryngology. In the otology practice, we like the argon laser and the machine, we use the so-called heat memory piston. That means that the piston is positioned around the incastment process, and if not like heat, the shepherd hook of the piston closed around the incus, which makes the positioning and the application very easy. This is the handheld probe, and this is the laser fiber which is pushed through the handheld probe. With the two cylinder extension of the fiber, we can manipulate around the corner everywhere in the middle. And also a very important part of our instrumentation is the micro drill, which helps us to create a little ball on the stage. This piston is a nickel titanium alloy with 0.1 millimeter diameter combined with fluoroplastic. This shepherd hook like structure goes around the incus, and the other end goes into the hole which is created on the stainless foot plate, and this is how we reconstruct the ossicular chain once the stay piece, the fixed stay piece, has been removed. These are the steps of the technique. The first step is the cutting of the stapedius tendon, cutting of the stapedius tendon. The second step is the laser vaporization of the crura. It's enough to vaporize the posterior crura because the anterior crust is very, very weak and easily tears. Then the third step is that the incus tapetum, the joint, is cut through with a small hook. The fourth step is creation of a rosetta. studies around the incus, and this is how you can reconcile the postcircular chain. Manipulation with the piston is not always easy. Sometimes it's just one movement in the incus, but sometimes, especially under experience, surgeon can use the piston. I have seen actually a very experienced surgeon in somewhere in Europe who lost three pistons within 10 minutes in the hypotympanum. But sometimes easy, sometimes difficult. Now you can see that the shepherd hook of the piston is around the incus, and the other end of the piston is in the inner ear. We have to fix the shepherd hook around the incus. That means that you just push it with the laser, you hit it with the laser. This is the most important step, and avoid scraping, which is a very, very controversial and difficult step. You hit it once and it closes around the incus. We compare our laser staphylotomy cohort with the conventional staphylectomy procedure. During the conventional staphylectomy procedure, to remove all the stapes, not just to create a hole. That's a little bit more extended procedure that creates a lot more trauma to the patients and to the inner ear. And these patients suffer from vertigo for a longer time comparing with the staphylotomy patients. So you can see the patient material regarding the staphylotomy patients, and you can see the patient material regarding the last conventional staphylectomy cases. When you compare the first staphylotomy patients with the 9 months follow-up, and in comparison with the staphylectomy last 10 patients for 18 months, probably you are not expert on analyzing the audiograms, but the audiograms and the post-operative endoscopy is much better, much more favorable when you just leave a small hole on the stapes play in cooperation with the conventional procedure and the wall stapes play. Also, some aspects of the comparison of preoperative postoperative hearing results. These are the staphylotomy regarding the first 14 patients with 9 months follow-up. You can see the best average average preoperatively and postoperatively. It's much more favorable when you compare it with staphylectomy. We published our first 44 cases back in 2004. You see that in about 98% of the cases, the postoperative airway gap was within 20 dB. Nearly 80% of the cases, the postoperative airway gap was between 1 and 10 dB, which can be considered regarding the international features, a very, very good result, I think. So, there are some tips and hints. Theoretically, it seems to be possible to preserve the integrity of both the pubic stapedia joint and the stapedia tendon. We don't consider that extremely important. Professor Fish from Zurich recommended the reverse of upstand techniques. What does it mean? It means that he positioned the piston on a fixed postcircular chain, so in reverse instead. And once he had positioned the piston on a fixed postcircular chain, he considered it a safer procedure because the positioning is carried out on a fixed postcircular chain. And that means a safer background for the cochlea. And once he had fixed the piston on the fixed ossicular chain, he started to detach the incus stapedia joint, and after that he removed the fixed stapes. two more slides just to show you the newest generation of pistons. This is the so-called native on the Margaret piston. It looks like a Margaret flower. It means that there is a modification on the shepherd hook, which means that the shepherd hook touches the float process of the incus only on three points. That means the safety of the procedure, that increases the safety of the procedure even on a higher standard. This is the piston which comes to you from the company. There is a dummy piston included into the set and the final version of the piston. So over here you can see that it is also a peak memory piston. After applying the laser heat on the shepherd hook, it closes down, but there are just 1, 2, 3, maximum 4 points, not a total simple circumference of the piston, which touches the incus. And with this technique, with this modification, you can avoid the dreadful complication of this sort of stateless procedures, which is the necrosis of the long process of the incus. Now I show you the technique once more. This is again the left ear, cord tympanic nerve, oval window, round window, tympanic nerve is pushed forward. This is the cord tympanic nerve. This is the stapedial tendon. We create the rosetta on the stapes plate. Rosetta technique means just the weakening of the foot plate before you create the final hole with the laser. Once you have made it weaker, with 4 or 5 spots in close proximity to each other, you can use your drill and go through the stapes plate. That means that you open up the inner ear. Now this is the favorization of the anterior crest, posterior crest of the stapes. This is the separation of the incubostabular joint. I just would like to show you later dummy, how we check the piston with the dummy. Now you remove the piston, you can see the rosetta over here. With the use of this micro here, you can create a small hole of the stapes. Okay, so this is the dummy. The dummy comes with a funny colored thing inside the shepherd hook. Why? Because in some countries, like in Saudi Arabia, as a consequence of the very big heat, it closes down spontaneously. So they try to create that. No, you can check the piston with the dummy, and when you have checked everything all right, you can use the final version of the piston. You remove this protection ring from the shepherd hook. And finally, you can play with the piston. It's quite easy to play with this type of piston. The big head sticks to everything, and you don't have to concentrate on the fact that with the first touch, the